Buenos días a todos. Voy a explicar brevemente cómo utilizar la interpretación integrada de Zoom. Una vez que habilitemos la opción, en la parte inferior de la pantalla les va a aparecer un globo con la opción de interpretación. En ese globo les van a aparecer dos opciones que van a ser español e inglés. Entonces ustedes pueden escuchar el audio que quieren escuchar. Para todos los expositores, para don José y para Gabriela, es indispensable que seleccionen el idioma español, ya que ustedes van a hablar en ese idioma, y es para no tener interferencias con la interpretación. Entonces, a los expositores, por favor, seleccionar español, y a todo el público que está presente, pueden decidir qué idioma quieren escuchar, si español o inglés. Ahora vamos a decir lo mismo en inglés.
Good morning, everyone. We want to explain how, this is the interpreter speaking. We want to explain how the interpreting system works in Zoom, in case you haven't used it before. On the main screen of your Zoom platform, at the bottom where there's a line of icons, there is one shaped like a world map right there at the bottom. You have to click on that, and then you will see the different languages in which the meeting is taking place. If you want to listen to English, click on English. And then you won't hear the main meeting, but you will hear me. I will be interpreting for you. If you need to take the floor, say you have a question you want to ask, you can do that in English, but you will need to turn off the audio from the interpreting. So unclick English before you ask your question. And I guess that's all you need to know. Thank you.
Perfecto. Entonces en este momento vamos a iniciar la interpretación. Y yo le pedí a los expositores que por favor de una vez seleccionen la opción, ya está habilitado. Entonces a Gabriela y a don José que por favor seleccionen español y ya podríamos iniciar.
The interpreting has now been activated, so you can go ahead and choose your channel and we can proceed with the meeting. Before we start, Ricardo. Never mind. Go ahead, Marco. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this third day of our exercise for building this new system. You've been with us since the 22nd. We've had a number of discussions, chats, lectures, mentorships, and we hope that all of this has made it easier for you to move ahead with this work until we have our deliverables ready. Today, we have some excellent speakers with us and they will be continue adding input, especially concerning innovation. So I want to begin today's agenda by introducing Gabriela Ibarra. She is currently the innovation manager from the Alliance for Entrepreneurship and Innovation. She is a designer, multidisciplinary with 10 years of experience developing creative base systems for corporate innovation. She designs experiences, services, interior designing, and project management. She holds a master's degree in international business from the Polytechnic Institute of Hong Kong and is currently the manager of innovation for the Alliance for Entrepreneurship and Innovation of Ecuador, where she coordinates actions that will make it possible to develop the national ecosystem, fostering innovation in more than 50 Ecuadorian companies. She is a specialist in innovation and design. As you can see, she is an excellent collaborator for us today, and she will add great value to the processes you have already undertaken. So today, and which today will start being developed into a broader project. So I want to recognize Gabriela and ask her to go ahead and share her presentation. Good, thank you very much, Marco, for that introduction. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you, I want to thank Ika in particular. I'm going to share my screen with you. You can see it, right? Yes, Gabi, go ahead, we can see it. Thank you very much for this opportunity to share with you. I want to start by telling you a little bit about the organization I represent. It's the Alliance for Entrepreneurship and Innovation of Ecuador, AEI. We are a network of public, private, academic parties and also multilateral organizations who undertake a number of different actions and initiatives to push ahead the ecosystem for entrepreneurship and innovation in Ecuador. We work with the country's largest corporations, and we're growing and growing more all the time. There are more and more of us all the time who want to grow and build our impact. I'm here today to talk about a practical tool that we hope will help you in your process of developing solutions for this challenge. As you are aware, big ideas do not come alone in isolation. They're part of a process, and many of them are led, in fact, by different methodologies, principles, and ways of working. One of them is the one I want to tell you about today, which is known as design thinking. This is a methodology that is used very often in innovation. It's easy to understand, but it's also very broad-based. And because we don't have all day, I will try to go through it quickly and give you a summary idea of what it is all about. This way of working, of coming up with ideas and high impact solutions. As you know, the shortest, that in our logical way of thinking and making decisions, our brain always tries to find the shortest path to a solution. We like to repeat what we've already done. We like to use patterns, templates. We like to find something that will come through easily and quickly. So as we know, the shortest distance between two points is a straight line, and it's the fastest and easiest, but sometimes it's not the most creative. What design thinking does is develop a process of creative problem solving. We try to understand and provide solutions to our users' real needs. This is the most important thing. We are based on people and their ideas when we try to find solutions. We have three main concepts here, and they cut across each other in every innovation project we do. We always design for people, first of all. We always make sure it's technologically feasible, and we want it to be feasible in the business sense. It generates a business. If we put all of these three concepts together, we find that that innovation lies at the center, at the intersection, because it's based on the needs of people, the possibilities of technology, and the feasibility of a successful business. What design thinking tells us is that designing is a process, and these steps will lead you through your process of exploring designs and solutions to solve whatever problem it is you're trying to solve. There are five steps. There are other ways of outlining this methodology. Sometimes they use more steps, sometimes they use fewer, but ultimately it's the same thing. We're all moving in the same direction. So I summarize it into five steps. Empathize, define, idea, develop a prototype, and evaluate. Empathize means get inspired and try to understand your client's problems. Define the challenge that you need to solve. Idea, this means come up with one or more possible solutions to the problem. Prototype, it has to be fast, cheap, and simple. And evaluate, look at it, test it, examine it, and figure out whether it's really a good solution. The process of design thinking can divide it up this way. The yellow shape at the bottom. This is where our thinking starts with an idea. Then it broadens to a whole world of possibilities by means of empathy. Once you have to define and empathize everything that you understood through empathy. And when that happens, this funnel narrows again, and you get to the next stage, which is ideation, coming up with new ideas, imagining the whole world of possibilities and ideas that you can consider. You develop a prototype, and finally you come up with a good solution. Remember always the most important point. Design thinking is a person-centered approach for innovation. It uses design tools to combine the needs that we identified that these people have, the possibilities we have from technology, and the requirements available for making this business successful. Before we start, there are a couple of things I want to explain about the experience that you've been involved in with multidisciplinary teams teams for generating ideas, for proposing projects, and to say at the end, this is what I want, this is the world I want to see, and this solution will help. What's the most important thing when we work, when you work on an innovation project or designing on a team? First of all, you need to know yourselves and know your team. Know that you that you have creative trust. All of you, creative confidence as well, a way to understand and manage the world with certainty that we can provide solutions. And I'm talking about confidence in yourself and your team members. If I'm an expert in innovation, it doesn't mean that the person next door who is a human resources expert can't help. He can help. He just has a different perspective than mine. And richness lies in how we combine perspectives and ways of thinking. We always need to be ready to live with ambiguity. We don't always know the answer. What we know is that there is a problem and there has to be a solution somewhere. Creatively, this helps us to explore possible solutions which may or may not work. And that's part of the process. And it's all right. And this is what helps us to keep going. We need to know that it's important to learn from our failures. Failure is a learning tool, a very valuable one. And finally, we need to always hold on to our optimism, because design and the proposal of designs and solutions, all of this is in essence an optimistic process. In order to address big problems, we first need to believe that that process holds the solution. And whether we know it, we know what we know, we don't know what we don't know, we're comfortable with ambiguity, we're willing to accept failure, and that will lead us where we need to go. So how do we work on these projects? First of all, we need to define the project, the problem that needs to be solved. We call this the design challenge. The important thing is to think about who will benefit from the solution. After that, the next goal is to frame the initial design challenge. That is, come up with a question. Ask a question that will help make your ideas flow, that will help you generate design opportunities. In order to do this, all we need to do is answer a simple question. What is the problem we are trying to solve? Or how can you solve it? How can you do this? How could you do this? How could you do that? This question will help you begin to generate ideas together with the rest of your team. I want to tell you a story here. It's a story about this young boy in Peru. His name is Jose Adolfo Quisocala Condori. At the age of 15, he already owns his own bank. He created a financial system that fulfills the dreams of more than 3,500 children in his home city of Arequipa through what he calls eco moneda, eco coin. What did he do? What did he start doing? In his hometown, he saw a problem. He saw that adults did not know how to save. The adults in his society, his community, did not have that concept of saving. And he saw them passing this along to the young people, to children, and children also did not know how to save. They would work from day to day, from hand to mouth, to survive and have what they needed, but not thinking toward the future. He wanted to help children in his city, children his own age, to learn to save, to learn to set goals and meet them and plan. And he did this through a very innovative solution, understanding and having empathy for his context. He said, "My friends, all the other kids, earn a few coins here and there. They collect bottles for recycling. They collect boxes and take them to the factories and they get them a few coins. I'm going to ask these factories and companies that instead of giving us a few coins, that instead they would load the money onto this virtual card." And he worked up the card in with a bank. They helped him. So this is where they received their eco coins, their payment. And the idea was that everyone who had this card needed it to define a goal, a dream. What do you want to do? Where do you want to go? And many of the kids set out their dreams. They said, "I want to buy a bicycle," or they said, "I want to take a trip," or they would say, "I want to buy this toy. How much does it cost?" "Great, this is what it costs." With this card, you couldn't take out the money until you had enough to meet your goal, to fulfill your dream that you had defined yourself. So he provided a solution that started off as a problem. He started thinking about how to help. And this leads me to the next point, the first step in this whole process of design thinking, which is empathize. That's what he was doing, empathizing. At this stage, empathizing, you try to understand people. You observe, you ask the right questions, you understand their needs, their feelings, and all the desires that will help you find ideas to improve their lives. To do this, there are a number of tools available. You can do immersion exercises, that is, put yourself in the person's shoes. You can interview them. You can interview experts. You can simply observe. And there are other things as well, techniques you can use to try to understand more deeply what exactly is happening, what they need. A key in this stage is to understand feelings, emotions, their faces, their expressions, their eyes. Learn to read people. Learn to understand from watching them what they're feeling. If they're unhappy, if they're resentful, if they're unsatisfied. If you understand these things, you can find solutions. The next stage then is to define. When you define, you work with your entire team to build a viewpoint, a benchmark based on the needs and perceptions of users. At this point, you identify insights, such as key results, hints and data. Is someone's microphone open? Thank you. You define a focus of action. What are you going to work on? What do you want to achieve? In order to do this, you need to figure out what the users want, what they need, and why. Why is very important. That's insight. Why is the focus of action that you can identify from the whole process of empathizing, everything you discovered in the last stage. In order to synthesize, it's important to take note or to note down or use post-it notes or write it on the wall or on whatever you decide to use with your team. What you learned from the exercise. What is coming up over and over again? What are the biggest problems? What annoys them the most? What makes them the most unhappy? What solution and how can we solve it? When you do this, you can design a new question, a more specific question, a more targeted question, which brings down to earth what it is people want. And you will see that later in the PDF. I sense I won't go into detail, but this gives you a tool with a number of questions that you can use to identify or to reformulate, from starting with your initial challenge, reformulate the final challenge based on the exercise of empathy that you already did. You can also decide who your client is, who will actually benefit from this solution. And in order to do this, there's a tool you can use, which is called the customer person. The customer persona, which gives a profile to the needs, behaviors, and experiences that this particular group of clients wants. And again, I will give you an example. I want to close this part going back to the example of Jose, because at the stage of empathy and definition, what did he do? He found a problem, he looked into it, he investigated, he talked to two organizations and companies that could help him, and then he set the challenge for his client segment. This wasn't all children, just any child. These were children in his hometown of Arequipa who had the same problem he had, who needed to learn how to save. So what was he able to do with this? He was able to grow through a solution that would provide a solution to other children beyond Peru, and also other cities in Peru and beyond Peru. And in a sense, it provided him an easy, innovative, simple way to offer a solution based on his own knowledge, his own situation. I want to give you another example. This is an entrepreneurship. This is a project in Ecuador. Yakupura designed a project to help people protect the environment by preventing the use of plastic water bottles. What they designed was a filter that attaches, it's the blue filter you can see in the picture, it attaches to the faucet, any faucet. Every filter replaces approximately 500 plastic bottles. So this helps them save and reduce the use of plastic bottles by so many people. What was important about this? It was based on a real need, a problem that Ecuador has. The amount of plastic waste being developed and being generated in Ecuador, and also access to safe drinking water that is fast, simple, and that any person can have. This filter, which is produced with the use of recycled material, is very economic. It's affordable by many, many people in the country. This leads me to the next stage, which is ideation, which is, again, we're going on with design thinking. How do we ideate? We have already talked about empathizing, about defining the points of action, and now we start to ideate. This is where we need to generate all of the ideas we can possibly come up with. We do it with the whole team. We will use the information that we developed in our research, and we will identify the main themes. The important thing is that every idea is valid. If anything comes to mind, write it down and propose it. And this is how we start finding creative solutions. One technique that can be used for group creativity is brainstorming. Here, we generate ideas about a subject or a specific problem or concept, and we always have to ask why. This team exercise is always interesting because if I give an idea and someone else says why and why this, why that, it forces me, it leads me to continue creatively thinking, exploring, writing until I'm able to write down the details of everything I'm thinking about, and maybe someone else on the team can add to it. Or maybe someone else is thinking the same thing, but expressing it differently. And this is how we develop the insights and the patterns of thinking that tell us where to head, where the answers lie. We have tools here that will help us explore ideas creatively. One of them is what we call Scamper. The name is very clear. The initials themselves explain. These are the ideas you can come up with, and it's based on the acronym SCAMPER. S, substitute, C, combine, A, adapt, modify, propose, eliminate, and reorder. Let me give you an example. When I was in Asia, my team and I had the challenge of designing a solution for baby strollers for young mothers in China. We needed to develop empathy and definition, identifying the lifestyle of these mothers in China. It took a great deal of work, field study in order to figure out what the problem actually was and identify different patterns and lifestyles of the young mothers of China and how a baby carriage could be adapted to provide a solution. At some point, we did this scamper exercise. I'm going to explain to you how we used it at that time. We said, this is the stroller that we need to work with. We need to divine, to figure out a solution. And we had an insight. The insight was that young mothers in China did a lot of trekking. They liked to hike. They would go out to the mountains and take long hikes. So we said, well, what if this stroller, and we use the idea of scamper. What if we switch out the wheels? Instead of using the small wheels they have right now, what if we put on bigger wheels, tough wheels that can hold up to hiking, like an all-terrain vehicle? What about if we adopt this other trend and we combine the stroller with the health trends that we see among young mothers, and we can include gadgets from yoga mats, for example, jump ropes and so forth. It's all part of the fitness trend. We can combine these concepts. So you take your children and you also meet your own needs for exercise at the same time. How about if we adapt it? How about if we switch out the usual handle, stroller handle, in such a way as to make it easier to do exercise? And what about if we change it? Another trend we identified, for example, was that Chinese mothers, parents love to travel. They don't want to sit in the house. How about if we modify this cart to make it adaptable, simply adaptable, and easy to travel with? And how about we also propose technological solutions, such as a GPS? So while you're touristing or while you're traveling around, you can make sure of where you're going, and you don't have to get lost, and you can't. It was that simple and that fast, and that's how this tool works. when you have a basic idea. You start asking questions, you start questioning what would happen if this, what would happen if that, and you break the barriers, you break the paradigms. And this is how I would like to wrap up this story from Yaku Puda, because in their design process, they did not start with this idea. They had other ideas, other prototypes, other solutions, but as they went through this process of creative design, they finally came up with this solution, which was not what they had anticipated, because it was the most easily adaptable. It could use, and it was based on recyclable materials, and they were able to come up with it only after a careful process of iteration, of design, of adaptation. And they're still brainstorming, they're still at it, because this process never ends. They're still coming up with new ideas about processing materials, but they have their product and it's out in the market. There's another story I wanted to tell you. It's about another entrepreneur, Ecuadorian, called Questionarix. What these people did was to develop an online platform. In Ecuador, if students want to enter the university, they need to take an exam. Everyone does. It's an entrance exam. It's called Ser Bachiller, be a degree holder, be a college graduate. And it develops many, it generates many ideas. It triggers a lot of emotions in students. They're uncertain. They don't know if they're ready. They lose confidence. So what we did was to generate this platform, which would make it accessible, fast, and easy to understand as they train students to take this test. During the whole process of design, they applied design thinking, and they empathized with a local problem, they understood the client, and they designed a solution based on an idea, which was to generate these training courses for Ecuadorian students who aspired to enter the university. This takes me to step four of design thinking. Step four of design thinking, prototype. This is where, at this point, you have an idea and you wonder how you can build it. The most important thing for you to know here is that you don't need to go into in-depth design for your idea. You can use any tools you might have at hand, because the prototype is based on giving life to ideas simply and quickly. We can be tangible here, whatever your brain is capable of thinking of, in order to test your ideas and get some feedback. And finally, this makes it possible to learn what it is we're still missing, what's the perception of our solution, so we can make it better. Prototypes can be any size. They can be small. You can use Lego, for example, as you see in the picture, or they can be large-scale prototypes, such as what was done in this project. It was a company that was implementing a solution for airplanes, for airlines. They set up a physical airplane with airplane seats and with walls that simulated the airplane. The spaces were measured out perfectly, just like the inside of an airplane, in order to simulate the solution they were testing and to figure out how people would react as to whether or not this was in fact a solution to their problems when they travel. We also have other types of digital prototypes where you don't need to develop a website or a model. You can use sketches. You can use websites online so that you can develop prototypes that don't have any development behind them. And it helps you quickly design the story that you're trying to tell, the landing page that you want to come up with. Or what happens if you click here, if you click there, if it opens up or doesn't open up, here's a button, there's a button, what happens with them? And with this, we can approach the client and say, look, here's a possible solution, test it, tell me what you think, browse it. What do you think? Would you come back to this? What else do you need? And use this feedback to improve it and get to the next step, which is evaluation. And when it's time to evaluate, what you do is follow up on everything you've learned, all the lessons learned when you introduce your prototype to the client. The idea of this step is to give life to the ideas, create the prototypes, validate with the people, implement improvements, and go back into this circle. The validate, validate, validate. It's a circle. You do it over and over again until the idea has a validated prototype that is strong, consolidated, and considers different perspectives and solutions that this person, our client, might be needing. And always remember to measure the results. So this is what Questionarics did. They created their platform, and as people used it or clicked on this button or clicked on that button, they would change it. They would put in a better one. If people had trouble finding where the classes were, they would improve that. So they went back and back through the loop, the improvement loop, based on the needs of their users to solve the problems that their users were having. So I want to summarize here how the methodology works. This methodology used by many companies, many innovation teams, many entrepreneurs. Again, design thinking, there are five steps. The first one is to identify and empathize with the problem that you want to design a solution for. Number two, define the challenge. Once you understand the problem, what is it you want to do? What do you want to do about it? How can you generate a solution and what for? Step three is to ideate solutions. This is the creative step, the fun part really, I think, where you can let your imagination fly, roam, and work with your team, come up with a consensus as to the winning solution, do a prototype, and then step five, evaluate, test, and improve. Thank you so much for your attention. I will now leave you, here's my link, which you can use, my LinkedIn, and we have some time for questions if you would like to ask them. Thank you, Gabi, for that excellent presentation. You have helped us with inputs and with practical examples of how innovation can be done. Innovation has a great deal of methodological support, and this is what Gabi has been trying to show you, showing some of the tools that are often used for innovation. I now want to open up the floor for the different representatives or teams of participants to ask questions or make comments for Gabriela. The floor is open. I don't know, do we have any questions? I'll be right there. Not yet. No, not yet. How about the chat line? On the chat line, we don't have questions. While we're waiting for some input, Gabriela, we will send any to you. We would like at this point to thank you for your presentation. I also want to reiterate to the participants and teams that these lectures from specialists give us tools for continuing to build our final proposal. Remember that this is day three of the challenge. You have a deliverable that you've been developing with initial ideas. In the second place, yesterday, you put together a video talking about the concept for the proposal. It's based on the lecture we heard today from Gabriela and the next two that we have scheduled, you will continue to have input in order to develop your final proposal. So we would encourage all of you, young people, to move ahead, to work hard on your developing your proposals with this input. We seem to have a question on the chat line for Gabi. I will read it out. Good morning. What are the most common problems committed in the phases of implementing design thinking? Thank you for that question. I want to make sure I understood so that I can answer and give you the answer you need. With respect to the different stages of the implementation of design thinking, what usually happens is that we don't start off with a good exercise in empathy. And as a result, we propose a solution which, as I said at the beginning, may not be what the client actually wanted, or it's not feasible technologically, or it is not economical, or it's not a viable business. These three features are critical, they're essential. Very often, the teams fall in love with the first solution they come up with. And that is where the process, yes, the process and the next stages start to fail. Because you get set on this idea and you don't want to let it go. You don't want to release it. So you go to the client and you say, this is it. And the client says, no, that's not what I want. I would never buy it. It won't solve my problem and I don't see what good it is. But since it's your idea, you designed it, you developed it, you're in love with it. It hurts. It hurts. And let me tell you, I've been there. I know it hurts. But that's, it's really important to learn how to let go of these things. Understand that it's not yours. It's not for you. It's for your client. And the more client-based you can be, the more focused you can be on the user, the more you empathize with the person who will receive the process will work better. Thank you, Gabi. We have a few more questions, which I will read out in a row, so you can take note and answer them all together. Let's see. Number one, how can the entrepreneurs you described, where did they get financing? Two, do we need to focus on just one problem, or can we solve a number of different problems when we design a project? And when it says empathize with whom? Another one, how can you quantify effectively when you're doing the evaluation? What's the best way to quantify in evaluation? How can I know for sure that the prototype is really working without bias? And then finally, what exercises in empathy can we use in order to make the methodology more successful? Thank you. These are the questions, Gabi. Go ahead. Very good. I'm taking note of the last one and then I will go ahead. Good. How can an entrepreneur obtain financing for developing these projects? You have investors, and what the investors always want to know is that your project is attractive to the market. You are not likely to get financing for something that's just an idea. You need to, if you are certain that this is a real need, if you're solving a real problem, and it's a problem for a lot of people, it will be a solution for many people and it can be scaled up. If all of that is true, then the work you do on your project and the development you come up with will start to create a buzz in the market. You start doing tests, you start talking to people, you start seeing results. Once you've done that, then you can come up with a final product. And after a certain amount of time, you can go to an investor and say, this is what I already have. This is what has been developed. I've tested it. It's not this direction, not that direction, but that's my competence. That's what sets me apart. And this is the potential for scalability. The example I gave of the child with the savings program, Jose, he didn't start and go to a bank the very next day and say, and they said, hey, we'll do this. No, that's not the idea. He started at home. He took his time. He talked to his friends. He kept notes. He said, I have a suggestion. I'll let you know when it's available. He set a goal. He set another goal. So this whole internal process unfolded until finally, he talked it over with one of his school teachers, and the teacher gave him some guidance. They went this direction. They went that direction. They validated it. Then finally, he was able to go to these big companies who saw the potential of what he had already done at his own school, in his own society, in his own little world, his neighborhood. And that was enough. That made it possible for him to grow. So the important thing is to develop the project well, to have some demonstrable results show that it can be scaled up. And this way you can get some financing. As to whether you define just one problem or several problems, very commonly when you have a big problem, a broad problem, for example, in my introduction, when I talked about defining the problem, I gave you the example of a person who had an initial challenge, which was how can we improve the lives of children? That's a big challenge. that's a question. It's a challenge. It's very wide open. So within that, how can, with this question of how can we improve the lives of children, you will find many arguments, many reasons, many motivations, many causes as a result of which children's lives are not developing as they should. So in the exercise of empathy, you question, you challenge, you understand, and in the end of the exercise, the person ends up with a new challenge, a challenge which is a bit more concrete, which is closer, and it becomes, how can the parents in low income communities make sure their children will do well and will flourish in their first 5 years of life? It's still a big challenge. It still has a lot of sub problems, but it's no longer unmanageably broad. How can you improve the lives of children? Because that it's unfocused. You can't bring it down to earth. It doesn't help. A question like that won't help you ideate because there will be too many solutions that aren't necessarily what people need. So you have a macro problem, but in the first stage, you have to break it down. You have to fine tune until you come up with a core problem. And even within that core problem, there will be other sub problems, but at least you will have a focus, a particular range of clients, a particular value proposal for that client and for the recipient. Then there was a question about how you measure. When you do the evaluation, how do you measure your prototype? I can't go into too much detail on that because we don't have all day, but on the internet, you will find something called innovation metrics. How do you measure an innovation project versus a typical project? And especially when it comes to evaluation stage, how do you validate these exercises with your clients in order to avoid bias, in order to avoid other problems, any detail that may lead you in the wrong direction, away from what the client actually wants? What I always recommend for entrepreneurs and people is don't validate with your family or your friends. They love you. They're close to you. They want to help you. And they will always say, oh, this is great. No, you validate with someone who doesn't even know you. You validate with someone who doesn't even have any relationship with you. You validate with someone who will not necessarily know that you are the one who are offering the solution. Don't pose it that way. They can take part in the exercise on an open footing. You can say, there's this project, sit down with me and validate this project with us and ask questions that will encourage the person to speak freely, to develop their own thoughts. Don't lead their question. Don't lead their answers. Don't ask leading questions, yes or no questions. Instead, open questions so that people, much of the evaluation depends on your ability to observe, your observation skills, their face, their eyes, their facial expressions. If it's something digital, are they able to use it easily? Do they get confused? Do they get lost? Do they miss a detail? Do they ask too many questions, which means they don't understand? So you have to be able to observe. It's part of the evaluation of design thinking. It's not a question of yield or payoff, or that's not what you're talking about. This is a whole different stage. We're starting to run out of time, but some more questions have come in. We have a few questions that we'd still need to answer. Maybe you could help us with some ideas on these questions, and then we can share. And we will set up a page, an electronic solution. Gabi, we want to thank you for your presentation. It's been very, very interesting, enlightening, innovative, as a number of the participants in the chat are saying, on the chat line, that the participants are saying this. And thank you for supporting this effort to promote innovation in building this community of rural youth. Thank you, Gabi. And now we can proceed with our next speaker. Thank you. We will now continue. We have a presentation, an important one today. Also, someone else who is with us today is Jose Manuel Dominguez. He is the commercial director of the fruit section of the Bayer Company. Jose Manuel Dominguez is going to talk to us today about innovation and the champions model. Before I give him the floor, I would like to tell you briefly who he is. Jose Manuel is an agronomist from Zamorano University in Honduras. He's specialized in integrated pest management at Zamorano. He also has a master's degree on business management from Ibarra, Mexico. He has 24 years of experience in agricultural markets in Latin America. He has experience with production of fruits, vegetables, and marketing and business. He's a commercial director in the fruit area of Bayer and works very closely with clients. He's a specialist in vertical agriculture, microgreens, and baby lettuce grown indoors. Based on his presentation, after this introduction, I want to recognize him to give his presentation today. Go ahead, Jose Manuel. Thank you, Marco, for that introduction. I'm going to load my presentation. Can you see it? No, we can't see it. Now, can you see it? No, we can't see it yet. It's starting to load. Go ahead. Maybe you could put it in presentation mode and then we'll be ready. Ready, go ahead. As Marco said, I have been working in this in agricultural markets for many years. I've been a number of years with Bayer. What I'm going to share with you today is how we see innovation in my company, not from our business focus, the creating molecules for the different markets that I will show you in a moment, but rather in our day-to-day work, in our business, day by day, we want to foster and we want our business associates, our employees, to hold on to that concept of innovation at all different levels. This is what we want. Also focus my presentation on how we had to change the concept of innovation as a result of COVID-19. I think it's very important to talk about that right now. Bayer is a multinational company. It's a big company. We have around 100 million euros per year and three major groups. Crop science and animal health is one. We also sell pharmaceutical products and research, radiological as well, and also we have consumer health. Consumer health is the area involving projects that do, these are non-prescription products such as aspirin, products that you can buy anywhere for remedies. Our innovation and creation are part of our DNA, but it's not pure innovation. We don't create molecules from nothing. We go through lengthy processes of research. They're very complex. And we use robotic systems. We also buy molecules from universities. We develop them. In order to put a molecule out into the market as a pharmaceutical product or for agriculture, it costs about $400 million a year, because of all the toxicological processes, ecotoxicological as well, and all the requirements that need to be met if you want to market a molecule. But I'm not going to talk about that today. What I want to talk about is our day-to-day work and show you how we try to extract innovation from our minds. In Bayer, what do we believe? We believe that innovation and digital transformation, right now we are fostering a lot of work with digital transformation. This is our new focus. After COVID, the world changed. There's no getting around it. And we have to talk about that from now on. So now innovation, it needs to go hand in hand with digital transformation. So this is the first big change that we are facing in our company policy in order to make changes, innovate with digital transformation. These are this is what will leverage our sustainable growth and business. For us, if I may, I want to shift this a little. This innovation can be solutions that are new or amended, creating value for our clients supported by profitable, sustainable business models. The key words here are business models. That is, our company is a commercial company. So the business, there needs to be a business model. It needs to be clear, profitable, and sustainable. Because we need to pay back the investment that we've made. But that's not enough. We have people whose job is to think and innovate. And the idea is that this should become a plan for the entire organization. This should be the practice for everyone, from the CEO all the way to people who are driving a vehicle, who are in a warehouse, protecting our products. So how can the company move toward innovation and bring about digital transformation? The idea is to create a culture, an organizational culture along these lines. Where do we, where are we innovating? We are innovating in networks. We are researching how we can do things in networks and business models, organizational structures, also processes. The production processes are very technical, and we want to work hard on processes. When it comes to the supply, we have product systems, efficiency of our products as well, these areas, experience, types of innovation, such as different types of channels, how to attract the attention of our customers and users, service areas and brand areas. Also, I want you to think about how we look at our at innovation, the different levels of innovation. The levels of innovation that we work with are the levels of innovation. Look, I want you to look here at the right. Are we familiar with the market, or is it a market that's new to us? Do we have a lot of information or of technology rather, or not very much? If it's a market we're unfamiliar with, we don't know much about, then it's a disruptive innovation, something entirely new. And it needs a lot of research and a lot of work. If we know a little bit about the market and we have some technology, then there could be two main headings: innovation, breakthrough innovation, which will have an impact, which breaks paradigms on this side, and sustaining innovation. This is when we are more familiar with the market. And then incremental innovation. This is where we know just about everything. We know the technology and we know the market. Most of the innovations that are coming out, the new ones, are under these headings. They come under sustaining innovation, and they come under breakthrough innovation. Now, here, in order for us to be competitive in this digital age, Bayer needs to work toward a focused transformation, a targeted transformation. I want to say this. We are focused. We have an external focus here in this, and we also in this quadrant, and we also have an internal focus on the other axis. The three areas of focus, the three targets we have are, number one is in digitizing the customer experience. Number two is new business models. Number three is digitizing operations. We have some examples. Example of number one, which is digitizing customer experience. Again, this is the customer era. We want to provide better platforms for research platforms for consumers. Number two, new business models. Here we are digitizing agriculture. This requires business models. Here's an example. This is, for example, digital weeding processes with cameras, monitoring systems for pests and diseases, better innovations to reduce the amount of agricultural inputs or pesticides being used per hectare. And number three, changing production systems to more digital systems. The strategic pillars that we have, I will mention two of them in particular. Experimentation is one. This is critical. Ecosystem. How this project or this idea affects the ecosystem of our working environment or production environment, culture and predisposition. This is something we need to address vigorously in our organizations, because it needs to be like a wave that you create where we're all thinking about different things and we're all trying to innovate. And then finally, communication. This is critical. There's another important subject, contributions. We're talking here about co-creation, experimentation, but above all, we need to minimize the risk of implementing it at a large scale. And I think Gabriela mentioned this. You need to start small, because sometimes we get so excited about a project, we're so in love with it. It's a new concept or idea, and we try to fly too high right from the outset. Do we have the resources to do that? To do this? Maybe, maybe not, but we try to take off. But the experimental formula needs to start at a smaller scale. We start with small things. We experiment with small business models, and then we go through trial and error. We experiment, so that you can grow little by little. This is the process of experimentation. The idea here, all of these have the Bayer trademark. All of these, it says Bayer there in the three different circles. Oh, it spells out Bayer. It's an acronym, and it spells out Bayer, those circles. So we have an implementation team with specialists in each different country. Bayer has companies all over the world, every country of the world. A person or a working team on site working with this concept that we call the champion concept. There's a person in Nicaragua, for example, who is the innovation champion. This person is responsible for collecting ideas, capturing ideas through a mechanism of meetings and training events. Maybe I'll talk more about that later. He captures ideas. He coaches the idea. And the ideas grow and deepen until they are brought before a regional coaching team, where we build on these ideas. Some flourish, others don't get beyond that. The idea is to seek out a challenge, analyze, and inspire. This is the idea of the concept, information processing. Then the idea of iCreator. This is the organization, access to resources. And then the process of development, which is where you build and test and evaluate and also gain access to resources. Then finally, replicate and expand. Evaluation, communication, and documentation. That is our experimental process. So what happened with coronavirus? As I said, this was a watershed moment, a line in the sand. In agriculture, for example, our agricultural department, our processes for development of molecules mean that you have to go out into the field, you plant a demonstration plot, you demonstrate the advantages, you show the users and customers, and then they ultimately would buy the product. But coronavirus changed everything. It changed our traditional business model. and it also, suddenly we were confined and we had to ask, how do we use all these tools? Because it's all we have and we can't even go out of the office, out to the office. So how do we get everyone together? How do we communicate with each other on our team? And then having done that, how do we communicate with our consumers, with our customers? A few ideas came up and we began adapting and readjusting and go back to researching, because the trends among consumers changed completely. And you will see that in a moment. So we need to pick up speed, go faster. The whole process needed to move faster, because if we weren't moving fast enough, if we continued to do what we always did, it wouldn't work. So we need to move very quickly toward digital transformation if we ever hoped to meet our goals without losing focus with our commercial operations. So how did we transform? We asked ourselves quite a few questions. We said, how do you transform the way we traditionally operated? I will give you some examples of all of these questions. We never used to hold teleconferences or virtual conferences on our products, because our products are very technical. So we felt that it's like the pharmaceutical product reps. They go to the clinic, they talk to the doctor, they leave samples, and it's all personal. The same thing in agriculture. We have extension agents, we have demonstration plots, and we go out there. So now how do we present our products? Because we did it all personally. We went out and gave a lecture, but now everything has to be done digitally. Zoom, BlueJeans. We give our presentations. We've hired a large number of specialists simply to gain access to our customers. We have changed our whole philosophy of giving more technical content and less marketing concepts, because people want more information, because physical contact is gone. How do we generate value without physical contact? This is what I was talking about. The digital tools have become key. Now, for example, there's a banana pest called cochinilla. It's a sucking insect that damages the stem of the banana. It's a mite. But we have less workers out in the field because people are staying home, taking care of themselves. The producers no longer have the labor force. They used to need to go out and supervise the banana plantations. So we had the idea of, why don't we do this? Why don't we hire someone and we can use digital photography instead? So we're working on taking pictures of the plants with the pest. These pictures, we take them to a digitizer, which does logarithmic analysis to determine how much mealybug is in the banana plant, and take that to a digital platform or a telephone and make recommendations to our agents who are now out on the farm because they can't go out, they're home, in real time, as it's actually happening on their farm. So John Brown pulls out his telephone, takes a picture, and we know exactly what's happening on his farm with respect to the insect population, so he can make a decision as to whether or not to apply a pesticide. The whole model changed. We had to readjust. We had to learn how to leverage exponential technologies in order to deliver value to our clients. And then how do we generate experiences? And this is a little bit of what we've done. We've had to give more online lectures. We have realized that we need to understand more and better the new behavior patterns of our consumers and stakeholders, our trade partners, our business partners. The world has changed The world has changed and we need to go back and rethink the behavior patterns of our customers. We need to speed up our processes and projects for innovation and digital transformation. That's part of the strategy I was just describing. Our home office has implemented waves of technology implementation, and we need to decentralize decision-making to the countries and groups. If I have a good idea, for example, I don't consult as much as I used to. I can go ahead and implement it in my area of action. These are some examples. We held a recent survey, 500 questionnaires, and I'm going to read them all out because it's interesting to see how the world has changed. And who goes out most often to buy food during the quarantine? 67% men, 30% women, and 3% the children. This changed completely. Before, this was not the case. It was women who did the shopping. But now the men are doing it because women are taking care of the children. And the man decides to expose himself to possible infection. It's a rational decision. At least that's the trend. During quarantine, we 37% preferred to buy brand name products instead of experimenting, testing. That is to say, they buy brand names they had never bought before. 37% are trying out new products. How are people doing their food shopping in the home? 95%, excuse me, how 26% home-based apps, 21% website or store apps, 20% domicile home delivery. If you cannot find certain products or brands, do you look for another brand? 56% said yes. So when you're developing your project, if you had certain ideas before COVID, you better rethink. I think that's the message I want to give you. Everything has changed. Unquestionably, there was a line in the sand, a watershed moment. People can't travel, and people can't go out to the stores as much as they used to. I want to tell you a story, something. The fruit market. There are certain crops that are in much more demand than others. For example, bananas in our country. Bananas are consumed more than melons, for example, or more than other fruits. So if you have a banana project, you're more in line with what people are buying, more than pineapple, more than mangoes. This was not the case 4 months ago. So if you, young people, are about to undertake a project, you better think about the market. You better examine it all over again, because the way it was before, it no longer is. So you need to focus on that. Whether for new projects or for existing projects, we need to rethink everything and ask how we are doing things, because everything has changed. The subject, the point here, the main actions that we can discuss, the subjects we need to understand, so it's what we call our mindset. That is, how do we think? How do you think? How does your mind, what are your predispositions in your mind? This is critical for developing new ideas. Attitude. No. Yes, there was a problem with the interpretation. It's now been corrected. It's corrected now. No, but it's not. The interpreter made a mistake, and now the speaker is confused. The interpreter apologizes. Where it says participants, chat, share screen. Then it says interpretation. I can't hear myself now. It seems to have been corrected. So the subject of attitude is important. Behavior, the person's behavior, definitely we need action. And performance, we need to make it happen. In order to have an idea, first of all, you need to have time to think about it. Unquestionably, you need to think. You need to have a positive attitude if you want to transform your idea. We need to get excited if you want to make a change. For me, one of my advice is if there's something you want to do, then dream about it all the time. Hold on to that dream. Get excited. Fall in love with that idea. This is the engine that will push you toward developing your idea. Where do you get the resources? If you're excited, if this is really your passion and this is your dream, the human brain works. That is, when you have a need, when you have the passion to make something happen, you will do it. So first of all, what we need to do is work on your own attitude, your own as a human being, get excited and put some gasoline into the concept. So fill your tank so that you can make it happen. In the company, this is the way we have structured the way of developing technological innovation models or innovation at the company. We hold introductory webinars. Yeah, what is digital transformation? How do you stay relevant in a changing environment? Then we have online courses, about segmented courses by the different roles in different areas. We're developing this new culture. But we need not just say it, but we need to do it. Design thinking and other tools so we can create this culture with our people. 3 virtual sessions where we talk about the data mindset, new ways of working, e-commerce, etc. This is how we can structure this way of talking to experts and learn from them. And show, so we can show and what our ideas are. Workshops, ideation, elimination of cognitive fixation, understanding technology, etc. Communication is ongoing. The messages so that we could promote the courses and the workshops. These are the teams. And we have teams all over the region and all the regions, and they work together with the whole innovation community. They come up with the best ideas. There's a whole process of extracting ideas, which is what AEI is doing right now. We extract ideas, we develop projects, provide knowledge, we set up a platform to make it happen. It's basically the same thing that we do in the organization. And it's done on a permanent basis. This is ongoing. To close, we are transformed, and at the same time, we work together with our stakeholders to be transformed. We work together, we can reinvent ourselves and work better. These are key messages of what we've been talking about today. Cooperation is very important. We need to work together. The culture and the mindset that you need to have. Remember what I said about passion, about living and falling in love with and dreaming of your idea. There's a stage of idea development when you're excited and believe in it. Exponential technologies. Digital technology is what changed the world. And we need to, every time you think of something, think about how you can digitize it. Whatever the idea is, think about how you can digitize it to share it with the world. We need ongoing learning. It's full time. It's not enough just to work with what you've already learned. You need to keep learning. In our own case, we have a global strategy, but action is local. And definitely a key point is focus. Do not lose focus. If you focus on one innovative idea, then work on that idea, develop that idea, focus on that idea so that your resources and your time and your energy can go into that and everything and make it happen. Innovation is basically innovation and digital transformation are not an extra burden. Instead, it's a whole different way of tackling business challenges and solving them. So that's what I wanted to share with you. Thank you so much. This was a pretty tight summary. I have tried to summarize just the main ideas and the things that we are doing. Anyone could, you might say, well, it's a multinational company. They have endless resources. A company of this kind needs to innovate. And as I said before, we do innovate, but all of the processes, as I said before, need a process of change. And we need to reinvent. We need people who are thinking every day about how to do things differently and better. Thank you. If you have any more questions, I can certainly take them at this time or later. Thank you, all of you. Thank you, Jose Manuel. Excellent presentation. It's good to hear about practical experiences from a company such as yours. And this gives us clear inputs for the young people who are working on their projects. You gave us a practical example of adaptation in a company that has contact with its clients as you work toward a model based on technology and virtual methods. And it's a very interesting challenge for the methodology that we are developing. So thank you. Thank you for shelling this in-house model on innovation and everything Bayer is doing in this process. We do have a quick question for you, Jose Manuel. Do you have a few minutes to try to answer some of the questions that are coming up? Yes, of course. We don't want to take much of your time. We've already gone over, these two presentations were very useful because they set the pace and they give major input to our young people. If you have questions, please, you have access to the mentee line, code 1554-67, so that we can answer your questions for Jose Manuel Dominguez from Bayer. Marco, we do have some questions on the mentee line. Jose, could you please turn off screen share so that Manuel can show us the questions that are coming in on Menti? Go ahead, Manuel. Yeah. In this digital age, do you focus on creating a new platform for doing e-marketing? This is a question from our e-commerce. This is one of our questions. Perhaps an initial reaction to this question. This subject, it's a good question because of the type of products we have, which require a great deal of technical advisory assistance. Think of, for example, of a medication, a pharmaceutical product that has not, so we haven't gone on to e-commerce per se for these products because of the type of product it is. We need to come alongside. There are companies, for example, our distributors that are exploring this concept of e-commerce. We're monitoring what they're doing and we're supporting them. Our business model is pretty much focuses on distributors out in the different countries. And our distributors are in closer contact with the final consumers. So the answer is yes, we're doing it through the distributors, but it's not always something we can do. It's not the usual way of doing business in our industry. Thank you. A second question. What is Bayer doing for the world's poor? Yes, that's a good question. We have an area. I work closely with ICA, for example, on something we call food security. There are many people and there are many resources that have been allocated to food security. We have a goal in the company, which is to help or at least ensure to prevent problems with the lowest income groups of people, help them in some way, we train them so that this will be a tool of transformation for looking to the future. Basically, in the area of agriculture, we focus on training, good practices, good agricultural practices. This is a subject where we have invested heavily, because a multinational company such as our own exports, we export fruits and we have the capacity to develop good agricultural practices so that we can export to Europe. We're not talking about small farmers in Guatemala who want to export coffee to Europe. We have specific programs where we provide tools to these small scale farmers with good agricultural practices. We help them develop. We help them become certified with the export companies. We also contact people in Europe or the United States who are buyers. So we have this program. It's called Food Exchange Partnership, and you can look it up on internet. We connect small farmers worldwide so they can gain access to the international market, because we believe that the way of helping is by training. And you do that by opening up markets. So that's what we're working on. Thank you. Here's a question. What strategies should we young people implement in order to promote digitization in agriculture and the rural and environment? That's good. Yes, I'm not going to answer about Bayer, but about something else I'm familiar with, which is vertical agriculture. This is really interesting. Vertical agriculture is a way of growing crops where you do not need land. You need a substrate. You don't need sun. You need artificial lighting. You don't need agrochemicals. You need a growth medium. I think that agriculture needs to focus on this. It needs to move in this direction, specifically for fruits and vegetables, especially vegetables. I feel that agriculture needs to be intensive. It needs to be more technical. When we become more technical, for example, producing on 10 square meters, you can produce in a 10 square meter backyard. You need to control temperature, humidity, everything. You can produce more and better than you could on the actual ground, on the earth. So I personally think that digital production needs to start focusing on vertical planting in order to minimize the environmental impact of traditional production in the open land. And this is a technological way to adapt digitization in agriculture. Thank you. There's another question. Jose Manuel, what programs does Bayer have for young people? Oh, that's a good question also. We are working worldwide to promote a concept, which is that every year, we develop what we have, the Young Summit. It's a meeting of young people. Bayer organizes the event. Last year, we worked together with AECA on this event. What do we do? And the same thing that AECA, it's the same thing that what AECA is doing now with this event and this platform is what we are doing worldwide. We also provide awards. We offer awards to young people in these forums when they come up with innovative ideas in their own countries. We invite them, they all meet together. This year we had more than 150 people in Brazil. Again, we have an award. program for these people. In this case, IICAS was a mentor for seeking work or job positions that might have been opened up in other places to help young people. So this is one area. And then there's another area where we are helping and cooperating with ICA, which is this hemispheric network of young people. I do believe that this is the solution for us not to destroy agriculture into the future. One of the big problems we have today is that there is no, that is to say, my father was a farmer, and I'm so grateful he was. That's what helped me. But other people don't want agriculture, young people that want to leave the farm because it's so traditional, because it's so this, so that. We are losing continuity, intergenerational connections for agriculture in the world. If we can help young people be attracted to agriculture, if it's attractive, if it sounds like something that they want to do, the only way we can do that is with technology, which is part of what AEI is doing. That's the way we need to go. It needs to become exciting. And we're doing that over this platform. And that's something we want to work on. Thank you, Jose Manuel. There's another question here, so we can wrap up with it. Is there does Bayer have some flagship program in Central America connecting the academic institutions with networks of young people in food, in agri-food? No, we don't. That's one thing we want to work on. In Central America, we don't have that kind of thing. We don't have a platform like that. And there's a need for it. There truly is. It's going to take a lot of work, but we will let you know, and we will ask you to work with us on that. Thank you, Jose Manuel. We have no further questions. We want to take this opportunity to thank you, Jose Manuel, personally, you, for all the support you've been giving us in this initiative from the time it first began, and also the institutional support we've received from Bayer to keep this project going. We are certain that when we get to the second part of technological development, we will find that young people who are part of the community of rural youth will be able to interact with support from a number of institutions. Again, speaking for the entire team, ICA team involved in this effort, we want to thank you, Jose Manuel, for the support you've given us. You're welcome. It's been a pleasure for me, and it will continue to be a pleasure for me to continue to do so in the future. Thank you. Thank you, Jose Manuel. We've gone over time, but this has been wonderful. We've been talking about subjects of innovation. We have two important source inputs that we've received from our guest speakers, and we are certain that they will add value to the process that all of you have undertaken, that you will need to continue developing over the rest of this afternoon and up until the 28th. We're going to wrap up the session and remind you that today at 2:00 in the afternoon, Costa Rica time, we will have another session where you will be able to receive some additional input on the subject of governance and diversity for the community. So join us at that time. We have a good afternoon, and we want to extend our greetings from our entire team.